Something happened here this last week. I talked to somebody. By the way, I left New York. I'm back in the woods in Tennessee. So what a blessing it was to spend some time there in the Bronx and meet some faces on the prayer line. Heard the voices, but got to meet the faces. Met another couple ladies last week, last Sabbath. They walked up to me and said, "My name is so-and-so," and I got to meet two or three more people. So now I have a visual idea of who I'm speaking to this morning. But it's an experience. It was shared with me about a children that had gone off to school and came home pregnant. And I'd like to address that subject this morning. My subject this morning is safe sex. So I'll pray before we start. All right. Dear Father in heaven, as we take up the subject of safe sex this morning, it is one that the world is, they have their ideas and you have your ideas. I choose this morning to receive your idea, your plan from the Bible. I ask in Jesus' name, amen. So we shall begin in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And if someone would like to read that, 1 Peter 2, verse 9. And this is a challenge. This is present truth. There are many verses in the Bible that are not present truth. When Noah gave the message, the flood was coming. Today, that is not our message. We have a different message. Present truth is 1 Peter 2, 9. Who would like to read that for us? So Peter's writing about, thank you, Peter's writing about, you know, a chosen people, and he refers to them as a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. And then our mission, to show forth the praises of him who's called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Sister Mirage commented on the fact that 7 o'clock, you know, in Eastern time, Elder Wilson's asked us to pray for the Holy Spirit. And of course, indicative in that of that prayer is we're asking for reformation. Reformation is not an overnight work. The Holy Ghost leads us back to God, and when he does that, always he leads back to God's law. That's gross darkness to the light of life. So if the law is the hedge that surrounds and protects the church, and I believe it is, if the law is the hedge, if the law is the backbone of reformation and revival, of course, revival comes first in reformation. Well, then if you look at the law, you see the fifth commandment and the seventh commandment. They safeguard the home. The fifth commandment, relationship between parents and children. Seventh commandment, the relationship between the husband and the wife. These commandments guard the home. Both are under attack by the devil. And the Lord's desire is to bring us into the marvelous light of his law. Now, he wants to enlighten the church, but he doesn't want to blind it. In Proverbs 4:18, it says, "The path of the just is as a shining light that shines, of course, out more and more unto the perfect day." God's plan is to enlighten the church, but not to blind it. Too much, too fast is overwhelming. But friends, if you're not living up to the light that we have, it's crippling. And the Lord wants the perfect balance. Now, let me ask you the question. The answer is in Leviticus 4. If you commit a sin of ignorance in the sacrificial system, were you required to sacrifice a lamb once you found out you'd been sinning in ignorance? Anybody know? Yeah. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. The verses, I'm not going to read them. It's Leviticus 4, 13, 14, 27, and 28. Leviticus 4, 13, 14, 27, 28, Leviticus 5, 15. It says very plainly that if you find out you've been doing something, a sin in ignorance, then you must sacrifice a lamb. Now, to me, when I read that, it shows me there are consequences even to ignorance. Even if you're sincere in your actions, there's still a consequence. I mean, we can agree, right? Even though you may be absolutely sincere. Let's say somebody that's, me, for an example, me. I remember I used to be a heavy drinker. I made my own beer and wine, okay? I thought that was healthy booze, healthy alcohol, right? I had no bisulfates, no preservatives. I made it myself. I control the process. I made beer and wine. I thought, well, this is healthy. It's good for me. Now, was that darkness? Yes. Was that ignorance? Yes. Will that still destroy my liver? Somebody say the answer. Yes, thank you. So even though you're doing something in ignorance, and God winks at it, I understand that. You know, God winks at it. He's trying to bring us out of darkness into the light. Nevertheless, there are consequences to our actions. And when you find out that you've been doing something that is a sin, transgression of God's law, 1 John 3:4, then you have to make a sacrifice. Now, 5T 595, somebody can go to 1 Peter 2, and we just read verse 9, but we didn't read 10 and 11. Let me read something, and then I'd like you to read verse 10 and 11. 5T 595, I'm reading from 5T 595. Men, and you could say women too, it's kind of a generic. When it says men, it means men and women. Men and women who are doing God's work and who have Christ abiding in their hearts will not lower the standard of morality, but they will ever seek to elevate it, elevate the standard of morality. So our subject this morning is safe sex. Now, 1 Peter 2, verse 10. And then verse 11. Now, when Peter wrote this, the church was growing rapidly. Many of the people coming into the church were Gentiles, Gentile converts. And there were some challenges there with the Gentiles. One of the challenges faced by the leadership in the apostolic church was fornication with the Gentiles. In verse 11, 1 Peter 2:11, Peter makes the plea, abstain from fleshly lust. And because it's at war with the soul, fleshly lust. But in Acts 15:28, it says it a little more plainly. Now, I'm going to read this if you don't mind. Acts 15:28. It seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. The you was converts from the Gentiles into the Jewish church, into the Christian church. And then verse 29, ye abstain from, and then this is the verdict of the apostolic leadership. This is what the Holy Ghost desires you to do. Number one, abstain from meats offered to idols. So food that was offered to idols on their altars, don't eat that. And then it says abstain from blood and from things strangled. And then lastly it says, and abstain from fornication, from which if you keep yourselves, ye shall do well, fare ye well. So in the apostolic church, a strong emphasis on the doctrine of monogamy. One man, one woman inside the relationship of marriage. The message from the leadership in the apostolic church, you cannot bring fornication into the church. If you do, it's not going to be a healthy climate for the church. Acts of the Apostles 195. I'm reading from Acts of the Apostles, page 195. The Gentile converts, however, were to give up the customs that were inconsistent with the principles of Christianity. The apostles and elders therefore agreed to instruct the Gentiles by letter to abstain from meats offered to idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood. They were to be urged to keep the commandments and to lead holy lives. They were also to be assured that the men who had declared circumcision to be binding were not authorized to do so by the apostles. Now, this morning I'm going to speak very plainly and frankly. My purpose is not to be offensive. May God help me to be kind and gentle. But I want to address a very real problem. And this is a problem not just outside the church, but inside the church. So let me read the last sentence again. They were to be assured, the Gentile converts were to be assured, that the men who had declared circumcision to be binding were not authorized to do so by the apostles. Dear friends, when the Gentiles received this message from the council in the apostolic church, the Gentiles were told to abstain from fornication, not to use condoms. That was the message from the apostolic church. The remnant church has the doctrinal positions as the apostolic church. The apostolic church had the apostles to direct the operation of the church, and you cannot do better than that. We have the gift of prophecy, but it's the same spirit that led the apostles to give this kind of direction to the Gentiles. And the Gentiles that came in were under the same governing principles as the people inside the church. And that was to abstain from fornication. They were not told to use condoms. I'd like to deal a little bit with the Planned Parenthood website and what they say about safe sex this morning. Adventist Home, page 112. I'd like to start with sexually transmitted diseases. And there are some statements in the spirit of prophecy regarding sexually transmitted diseases. I'd like to read one. This is Adventist Home, page 124, paragraph 3. Adventist Home, page 124, paragraph 3. You know, I like to quote a verse a lot. It's in Proverbs 18:22. He that findeth a wife findeth a what? Anybody know that one? He that findeth a wife findeth a... a good thing. But it means good woman, right? A good woman. Yeah, a good woman. Well, of course, you know, people say, well, if one's good, two must be better, right? Is that right? Do you know, if one wife's good, two wives must be better? Okay, no, thank you. That's what we would call, that's multiple wives, right? That's polygamy. That's an unholy practice. Now, Mrs. White addresses unholy practices. Adventist Home, 124, verse 3. The bedchamber where angels of God should preside is made unholy by unholy practices. Now let me pause to say for a moment, the bedchamber is reserved for the husband-wife relationship. Okay, God has sanctioned the bedchamber to be occupied by the husband-wife relationship. And that's one man and how many wives? Well, two must be better than one. No, one wife, right? That's a good number. Now, the next sentence, and because shameful animalism rules, bodies are corrupted. Loathsome practices lead to loathsome diseases. That which God has given as a blessing, the sexual relationship, is made a curse. Loathsome practices lead to loathsome diseases. Two wives, that's an unholy practice. But a sexual relationship outside of marriage, that's an unholy practice. I think we can agree, right? I hope you can, that the sexual relationship, the physical relationship, is reserved for the husband-wife relationship. If you have that relationship outside of marriage, the Bible defines that as fornication. And the Gentiles were under the obligation to give up fornication when you come into the church. Why? It's an unholy practice. Loathsome practices bring about loathsome diseases. Today, modern America, we face a panoply of sexually transmitted diseases. Chlamydia, genital warts, genital herpes, gonorrhea, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, syphilis, HIV, and I can go on and on and on. These are a list of, they call them STDs, sexually transmitted diseases. If you look on Planned Parenthood's website, they tell you how to have safe sex. In other words, they say this is how to commit the sin, but to escape the consequence of loathsome diseases. Well, you know, what's wrong with fornication? The Gentiles would say. And I think people today do not understand the dangers involved with fornication. Well, number one, of course, sexually transmitted diseases. But it's, you know, there are worse consequences than AIDS or syphilis. Let me read that again. It is reported commonly. Commonly reported. Dear friends, the word got out, right? That there is fornication inside the church. And such fornication that even the Gentiles don't do these things. Paul said, even the Gentile world, they don't commit this kind of crime. We're doing in the church what the pagans don't even do. I mean, this is the problem. It's come into the church, and Paul is concerned. Shouldn't we be concerned if fornication comes into our church? And if we license it under a misnomer of safe sex, dear friends, we're not after safe sex. We're after the holy relationship God has reserved for the marriage chamber. And Planned Parenthood is so far off the mark when it comes to biblical Christianity that if we make their mantra our guideline, we're going to be going straight toward the lake of fire. Because that is not the purpose of the husband-wife relationship to have sex. The purpose is to know Christ. A man and his wife, as they interact with each other, they understand a little bit more. Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. When a man loves his wife and the response he receives from her, and he sees the depths of feeling and emotion and tenderness and love and care and compassion for his wife, he's understanding something of what Christ feels when he looks at his church. And when his wife receives his love and returns it, and the man is blessed by that experience, then he sees something, a small bit of what Christ feels when the church loves him. A man is to learn about the relationship between Christ and his church in his own husband-wife relationship. But when you look on Planned Parenthood, and I use kind of Planned Parenthood as a symbolic word for the way the world thinks. Safe sex, according to Planned Parenthood, is you get tested before you have a sexual relationship, STD testing. And then you have protective procedures, equipment and certain apparatus that will protect you from the physical contact which will transmit a sexual transmitted disease. And then they emphasize low-risk sexual activity. But dear friends, there is not one word on Planned Parenthood's website about God's law. Monogamy, as God defines it, is extinct in the philosophy of Planned Parenthood. Let me talk about monogamy for a second. That word is defined as, in the Bible, the practice of being married to one person and the relationship that takes place inside that marriage. We call that a monogamous relationship. But today, the world has changed the definition of monogamy. Now it's just having a sexual relationship with one person at a time. That's what the world calls monogamy. You got one partner at a time. And before you engage in sex with that partner, you're tested. Make sure they don't have any diseases, and neither do you. And then you have a safe practice by using certain kind of protective devices like condoms. Even in the field of zoology, you know, animal study, they say monogamy is an animal that only has one mate at a time. That definition is not exactly Christian. Now, the divorce rate will not change unless God is introduced into the equation of marriage. And I'd like to start back in Genesis 2:24 and study God's plan, which does not include fornication and does not include safe sex outside of marriage. In Genesis 24, a man leaves who? He's going to leave his father and who else? And do what? And do what? What's he going to cleave to? And they shall be, now the important part of the verse, and they shall be what? Now, you think carefully. As we go along here, the last half, you think carefully. Before you answer, I invite you to answer, but think carefully. And they shall be one flesh. Is that a sanction for the physical or a spiritual oneness? A physical union or... Thank you. Both. Absolutely. All right. We can agree. Now, let's stick with the Bible. This is, I'll call it the package deal. You know, a man and a woman, they are betrothed. They are married. They are recognized by the world in a monogamous relationship. Now, that includes, we agree, it includes the physical relationship. But you also have a oneness in the spiritual, the mental, the social, the emotional. It's a oneness. The Bible calls it a oneness, one flesh. Now, you tell me, which is the higher union, the spiritual or the physical? So I marry my wife, and I did. We've been married 38 years. And then it is sanctioned by God. It is allowed. It is permitted to have a physical relationship. And of course, there's a spiritual relationship. But dear friends, what happens if I become a paraplegic and there's no physical relationship? Come on, what happens then? We're still one. You could, dear friends, you can lose the physical and the relationship. Thank you. The relationship can still be absolutely wonderful, right? You can lose the spirit. I'm sorry. You can lose the physical and the relationship is not damaged. Can we agree? Let's say a woman becomes a paraplegic or she has some kind of problem where she can't have the physical relationship. You know, that happens. Does that mean they have lost the beauty of the relationship? Does that mean it's been degraded? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Now, wait now. Now, let's flip the question now. If you lose the spiritual, but you still have the physical, have you lost anything? Yeah, you've lost everything. Because, dear friends, a man can go down the road and buy a prostitute and get the physical. Can't he? Hint is spiritual you can't buy. You can't. It doesn't feed the spirit. It is true, right? We agree. A man can go down. Right now, I can go into the city and I can pay and get sex. Yeah, that's not what God's talking about in the marriage. Yeah, this is not what God's talking about. Is it true? Is it possible that a man can have a marriage, have the physical, but not have the spiritual? Yeah, and that is a problem. Dear friends, if you are involved in fornication, you do not have the spiritual because you do not get the spirit in breaking God's law. That's it. You cannot have the spiritual relationship in fornication. And if you say you can, I say you just crucified Christ afresh. The Bible plainly teaches from the apostolic church banning fornication from the Gentiles coming into the church until this day. And we're going to study it modern day, Matthew 19, fornication in as present truth. You can't have the spiritual relationship. So no matter how much we encourage our young people to practice safe sex when they go off to Southern Adventist University, dear friends, they will never have a safe soul. You might have safe sex, but you will never have a relationship with Christ committing fornication, because sin separates from God, and fornication is a sin. And that is biblical truth. God's original plan for marriage was revealed in Genesis, where 2:24. These two shall become one flesh. But that's a husband-wife relationship. The Garden of Eden was a showcase for marriage, the Sabbath, country living, useful labor, healthy lifestyle. But all of those elements in Eden were protected by God's law and dependent upon God's law for happiness. When the law was broken, hearts were broken. The Garden of Eden was no longer a place of peace. Without obedience, Eden was no longer a paradise. Now, many, many years have passed. 6,000 years have gone past. The law largely has been lost sight of in the Christian world. Country living, healthy lifestyle, the Sabbath. What about God's plan for marriage? I mean, even today in Babylon, in apostate Protestantism, have they lost sight of God's plan for marriage? In many cases. Yeah. And then, if you have that, then you compromise the spiritual union because sin separates. Isaiah 59:2. Sin separates. Fornication separates our soul from not only God, but from each other. If a man goes off to the university and he has his condom and he practices safe sex, dear friends, separated from God in the act of fornication, you're still separated from your partner. There's no peace in that kind of thing. And this is the problem we face today. If we teach safe sex to our young people, we are separating them from Christ, because sex separates from God. Fornication is absolutely not in God's plan. Now, Matthew 19:4. Somebody run to Matthew 19:4. Now, New Testament present truth on the subject of fornication. 19:4. Okay, now, 19:5, the Genesis 2:24 language. Jesus is about, now my sister, I want you to read it, but wait one second. Jesus recognizes that the church has lost sight of this whole principle, marriage, divorce, fornication. They've lost it. And Jesus is making an effort to bring back the New Testament plan. Well, let me call it the Garden of Eden plan. Jesus wants to make the Garden of Eden plan the New Testament plan. He's trying to bring the plan back. Now read 5:6. Now, we know for a certainty Christ was trying to bring back the Garden of Eden plan, the Genesis plan, to the church. Next question. Did he meet with resistance when he tried to bring this plan back? Oh, yes. And that's not our guess. That's biblical. He met with a lot of resistance. Today, if you try to introduce God's plan into the church, there may be times when you meet with resistance. People will say, well, what about cultural differences, cultural sensitivities? This is the way we do it in wherever. Well, dear friends, the Bible bridges all cultures. Sin is not cultural. Now, we want to be gentle. We want to be kind. We want to be discerning. But friends, if we lose the Bible out of our thinking, then our thinking's not worth much. Now, Matthew 5:31. Somebody go to Matthew 5:31. Matthew 5, some of these are parallel chapters. Here's the problem Jesus faced. Jesus says it. I mean, this is Jesus talking in Matthew 5:31. Who'll read? Now, Jesus is bringing up the problem. It's Christ that's talking. If you got a red letter Bible, that's in red letters. It says, well, it has been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, give her, and somebody did say that. Jesus said that. He said it through Moses. But the Old Testament is as inspired as the new, right? In the Old Testament, the Spirit of God is still the testimony of Jesus, motivated by the Spirit of God, right? We believe what Moses didn't write is Christ writing through Moses. Moses is the instrument, but Christ is the source. The Holy Spirit moving on the heart of Moses. And Jesus himself said, well, put away your wife, give her a degree of divorcement. Somebody said that. Now the question is, who said it? The answer, Moses. Now let's read it. Deuteronomy 24:1. You go back to Deuteronomy 24:1. It's the divorce plan under the dispensation of Moses. 24:1 of Deuteronomy. Now, it's true, Moses is writing that, but he's inspired by the Holy Ghost. That is a picture of gross darkness. That's Isaiah 62. That is gross darkness. But, dear friends, remember, and Jesus is about to say it back in the New Testament, they were coming out of midnight madness. And you don't come out in one generation. Coming out of the darkness into the marvelous light, dear friends, it takes some time. God's people had become practitioners as the years passed. Let me change it into a question. Had God's people become practitioners of polygamy, taking multiple wives? Yes. Did King David have a few wives? And so, you know, it become common practice. Had they lost sight of the Genesis plan? Yes. You could take all the wives you wanted, and you could get all the divorces that you needed. And then 1,500 years after Moses wrote Deuteronomy 24, 1,500 years later, Jesus is bringing the Genesis plan back. Why did he wait so long? Because I tell you, friends, it took 1,500 years for their hearts to be prepared. The suffering endured. Yeah, they were hard-hearted, right? And that's what Jesus is about to say. I don't want to read it yet. But 1,500 years of suffering in the home kind of softens the heart up right in the mind. Moses' plan did not produce happiness. Because without stability and permanence in the marriage relationship, you lose part of the beauty of home life. So Jesus was bringing back the Genesis plan. Now Matthew 5:32. The light's growing brighter, right? Matthew 5:32. Now, let's look at this from the positive light, okay? Let's look at this from a optimistic angle. The act itself. And it says fornication, right? Fornication, the act itself breaks apart the marriage. The legal action of divorce recognizes the fact the bond has been broken by breaking the law. So, do you have a right to divorce if there is some unfaithfulness in the marriage? Yeah, friends, you do. But the act of unfaithfulness broke the marriage. The legal action of divorce, it recognizes the fact that the sin broke the marriage. Fornication doesn't bind a man and a woman together. Fornication breaks them apart. It separates them. Isaiah 59:2 says that. Someone that is divorced without grounds, they can't remarry. Why? It would violate the principle of stability, permanence, and security in the marriage union. Dear friends, commitment's not bondage. It's freedom. It's freedom. And the problem with fornication, a relationship outside the marriage, and dear friends, this happened once. You know, this is a long time ago in a different place. This is a long, but it happened. I was in the administration of an institution, and it was told to me that a man and a woman that I thought were married, that they weren't. They were living together, serving at the institution, but they weren't married. And of course, I went to the brother and the sister, and I said, you know, and I talked to the brother. I said, look, Are you married legally? I just ask him, right? The best thing to do is, you know, don't gossip, go and ask. I said, are you married legally? He looked at me. He said, no. And I said, well, you're living with this woman, but you're not married. And he said, I'm married in the sight of God. And I said, but you're not married in the sight of man. And the problem is, when men look at you, they're going to say you're not married. I said, why not go down to the justice of the peace or go to the pastor and make it legal? Dear friends, you know, I'll tell you one difference between having a... When I was a hippie, we called it shacking up. That's what we called it. When a man and a woman live together but aren't married, we said shacking up. The difference between shacking up and a marriage, yeah, that's what you call it. That's what we call it today, right? The difference between shacking up and getting married legally, I'll tell you the difference. And I told him, I said, in the eyes of God, well, the problem is the eyes of men. If you get up and leave tomorrow, then legally, you were never married. Legally, you're not divorced because you were never married. Legally, but you know, friends, if you're married legally by a pastor, justice of the peace, if you're married and recognized by the world as being married, you can't leave that woman and go marry another woman. It's illegal. That's illegal. You can't, in the States, you can't marry two women. That's illegal. You got to get a divorce first. But you can't get a divorce unless you have grounds, if you're a Christian. You can't, this I married in the sight of God thing, well, the world calls that shacking up. If you're going to live together, you need to get married. And if you're married, then you can't get divorced unless you have grounds. You say that, and then somebody will say, that's why I don't get married. That's why I shack up. So I'm not committed. Ah, my dear friends, what kind of marriage is that? No commitment. What kind of relationship? No commitment, no permanence, no stability. I can leave when I want to. That's what they had under Moses. That's what they had under Moses. You can write a little decree and you can ask your wife to leave and then you go marry another. And Jesus is bringing back the Genesis plan because that plan does not work. Well, why in the world would Jesus give them that plan in the first place? Why would he do that? The answer is simple, right? Matthew 19 verse 7. Let's read Matthew 19 verse 7. The same question we just asked, right? Now read verse 8, Sister Anne Marie. Verse 8. Never was God's plan. To meet man in his fallen, darkened condition, Moses downgraded the original plan to meet man where he was. Dear friends, that's plan B thinking. That is plan B. That is not God's plan A. Now the remnant. Are we under plan A or plan B? Are we on plan C, plan D, plan E, or does the remnant, is God calling the remnant back to plan A? Thank you. Yes, yeah, God's plan. And dear friends, we are the investigative judgment, October 22, 1844, when Jesus went in to cleanse the sanctuary, he's bringing back the best. Matthew 19, verse 9, I say unto you, who shall put away his wife except for fornication? Now here it is, full-blown Genesis plan. Or as you, my sisters, you called it God's plan, the best plan. Except it be for fornication, and you shall marry another, you commit adultery, and whoso marries her which is put away doth commit adultery. Jesus is saying that to Peter, James, John, Andrew, Nathan. He is talking to the apostles. And as the apostles receive the Genesis plan, what is their response in verse 10? No good. Yeah, no good. No good. His disciples say unto him, if the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to get married. It's not even good to get married. If this is the way it is, it's not good to get married. Dear friends, it is hard to change Plan B thinking. Would you agree? It's hard to change Plan B thinking. So the devil looks at our church and he brings in his philosophy of safe sex. That's Plan B today. Shacking up and living together now is the norm in the world. I saw an interview. Woody Allen, most of you don't know Woody Allen, talk show host, comedian. He was interviewing Billy Graham, and you all know Billy Graham. You know, he died last year, right? I saw Woody Allen interview Billy Graham. Now, Woody Allen was secular, he was an atheist. Billy Graham told him, in the eyes of God, Billy Graham was a Baptist minister, come on. He told in this talk show, he said, in the eyes of God, the sexual relationship is reserved for the husband-wife relationship. Woody Allen looked at Billy Graham and he said, that is crazy. In fact, you can see the interview on YouTube. You go to YouTube, search Woody Allen, Billy Graham, you can watch the interview. Woody Allen said, you know, what you're trying to do is tell a man to learn to drive, but not give him a learner's license. You know, you want him to drive a car, but not teach him how. You know, he was saying you need to live together first. And then we had a lady in our organization. A man asked her to have a courtship. Her father was not a Christian. The man called the father to ask for permission. And he told the man, if you want to marry my daughter, you need to live with her first for a year to see if you're compatible. Dear friends, shacking up is the norm in the world today. Isn't that true? Living together doesn't raise an eyebrow. I mean, isn't that true? Or is this, I'm not talking about inside the church. I'm saying the world. In the world, living together is fine, isn't it? Yeah, come on. It's normal. Now, that is an acceptance of fornication. But when the church accepts fornication, safe sex, sexual relationship without the marriage commitment, then we are worse than the Gentiles. As Paul said, not even seen in the Gentile world. So the answer, Planned Parenthood, no multiple partners. Okay, well, and you know, the one thing I don't want to do is, I mean, I don't want to lose my Bible, right? I want to keep my Bible. The way to keep the Bible is you got to obey the Bible, right? You may carry it in your hand, but that's not enough. Psalms 119:11, thy word have I hid in my heart. The Bible we need to carry in our hearts. And so if you say, well, I'm going to safeguard my children in the university, I'm going to say no multiple partners, get tested for STDs, use a condom, you know, hey friends, what about sexual purity? What about God's law? Why trample that underfoot to try to keep somebody from getting pregnant? Dear friends, the thing that will keep somebody from getting pregnant is to understand God's plan and to love it. That's what will safeguard our children. To be able to share the plan because we believe it and we live it. And when they embrace the plan, that is a safeguard for your children in the university. Adventist Home, page 344. And if you argue that God's plan is not the best, then I won't argue with you. But I don't believe you. God's plan has changed my marriage. I've road tested the thing. It works. Adventist Home 344. And somebody will say, well, you know, what about the Supreme Court? The Supreme Court said this and the Supreme Court said that. Dear friends, God's court is supreme. That's the Supreme Court. God's court is supreme. The Supreme Court is a lesser court. And when it disagrees with God's court, friends, I've got no use for the Supreme Court. I've got God's court, and court is now in session. And that all the earth keeps silence before Him. God is trying to lead the remnant back to Plan A thinking, which excludes fornication. Adventist Home 344. A woman may be legally divorced from her husband. By the laws of the eye, my sister, this addresses this common law thing. This common law and what the world recognizes. A woman may be legally divorced from her husband by the laws of the land, and yet not divorced in the sight of God and according to the higher law. There is only one sin, which is adultery, which can place the husband or wife in a position where they can be free from the marriage vow in the sight of God. Although the laws of the land may grant a divorce, yet they are husband and wife in the Bible light, according to the laws of God. And let me go back to that man that was living with the woman in our institution. You know, we're living together. In the eyes of God, we're married. Common law. I said, why not just make it legal? Why not go down and make it legal? Why not go down and get a pastor to do it and not have any shadow of doubt? And the answer was easy, because then he can't leave. Yeah, where's the commitment? And then you don't have any stability. If your wife can walk out, you know, it's just, you missed it. You missed, dear friends, husbands love your wives as Christ loved the church. If you don't have the commitment, the relationship, the stability, you missed it. You miss the best things. If you only do what's legal, then you miss what's best. And then and last but not least, Hosea 3. Somebody run to Hosea chapter 3. Husband and wife is a symbol of Christ in his church. Hosea, he was a real prophet. He married a real prostitute named Gomer. They had real problems, but it's a real symbol. And it's talking about some legal rights in the marriage. Hosea 3, I'll read verse 1, we're almost out of time. Hosea 3, verse 1. Then said the Lord unto me, as God speaking to Hosea, go yet, love a woman, beloved of her friend, yet an adulteress. The Lord just told Hosea to marry a prostitute. Was that shocking for Hosea? Oh, yes. The Lord said, you marry that adulteress. And then the last part of the verse, according to the love of the Lord toward the children of Israel, who took to other gods and loved flagons of wine. So that's it, right? The church was unfaithful to God, and he sent Hosea to marry an unfaithful woman. Because even though the church was unfaithful to God, dear friends, God was not unfaithful to the church. He keeps us. Even though we're drunk on the wine of Babylon, the Lord does not turn away. He wants to sober us up. He's trying to get his plan in our hearts. And if we could receive that plan, then we can give the plan. And the plan, if we were to teach that plan in our church, there'd be a whole lot less teenage pregnancy out of wedlock. Because God's plan safeguards the soul. When you're drunk on the wine of Babylon, 1 Peter 1:13, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. Well, how can you be sober? Ephesians 6:14, having your loins girt about with the truth. When we girt our children with the truth, it is a shield from 1,000 perils, especially when they go off to school. You want your children coming back the same way they went off, except a deepening Christian experience. When you prepare them with Planned Parenthood fornication philosophy, friends, you're going to lose your children. The shield of faith in Ephesians 6 is the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. We've got to send our people into the world understanding God's plan to safeguard His church. In God's plan, the same yesterday, Hebrews 13:8, today, and forever, I'll pray.